continue to pray as I stand before you. You know, Brother Dallas mentioned the ones in the Dallas, and that it really kind of got me to thinking about how the world is continuing to wax worse and worse. But we have to remember that any good that's in this world is because of our God in heaven. That is not because of man or what man's done, but it's because God in heaven has made good things happen unto us. And that He holds our souls and our spirits in His hand, and that He will never ever leave us or forsake us. That no matter what happens or what man does to us, that He will always be with us. You know, this life that we live here is just temporary. It's like the grass in the field. It liveth for a season, and then it withereth up and blow away. And that's just the same way that our lives are. That I believe God probably sees it the same, actually, because he's up there in eternity where we are not. While we're here yet in this time world, I believe that to God, it's already, He knows it all, and He can see the beginning or the end from the beginning. So unto Him, it's an eternal now, as I'd like to put it, that He knows all. But going away from that, I want to start reading a little bit in the first book of John, 1 John. And I want to read a little bit, and we'll go from there. Y'all continue to pray, please. In the first chapter, in the first verse, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard. Now he's talking about Christ, that he talked unto them, he preached to them, he taught them, and that they had heard him. Which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. Now that word of life that he refers to is Jesus Christ himself. Because over in 1 John, you know, he tells us that in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So he's talking about Jesus Christ here. For the life was manifested. Let me turn this down. It's whistling
in my ear.
Let's see if that knew a little bit. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. Christ came and lived on this earth as a man. And while he was here, he walked among men. It was the Son of God himself walking in the flesh and living as a man, so that he felt the same things that we do. He felt hunger, he felt cold, he felt the heat, he was tired, he was hungry. The same things that we feel. The only difference was that Christ was without sin, that he did not sin while he was here in this life, and he has no sin in it. Show unto you that eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. Now Christ lived here so that we could live with him in glory after he finished his work, which he did. He finished that work. That which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. Now, John is talking about a group of Christ, God's children, that he's calling us. And he's writing this book to others that are also children of God, so that they, who he was writing to, can have fellowship with the group or the congregation where John was, those people that he was spending time with. And then he goes on to say, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We come here so that we might have a little bit of fellowship with us, one another, but truly what we come for is that fellowship with God Almighty, that we might be able to share a little time with him, that we might be able to grow in grace, that we might be able to be instructed of him, to learn about him, and to be able to then carry on after we leave here and to follow him, to walk in his footsteps. And these things we write we unto you, that your joy may be full. Now, we're able to get that joy of when we're having that fellowship with him. You know, Paul and Barnabas first started their ministry, and they went out, and they had been across quite a bit of area, and they had decided that they were going to go to Jerusalem to see the apostles and elders, because the question came up. And that question was one of circumcision, that part of the law that at that time they were still trying to carry over into the church of Jesus Christ. There were some that kept saying that, yes, we're going to have to do that. But Paul and Barnabas decided that they're going to go to Jerusalem, and they're going to ask of them to see what they thought about it. And then in the 15th chapter of Acts, in the third verse, and being on their way by the church, that means they were sent by the church where they were at, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles. So as they went, they declared that the Gentiles were being converted just the same way as the Jews had been. And they caused great joy unto all the brethren. When we are able to fellowship one with another, with those that we have not seen, or those that are from another congregation, we feel great joy when we see them coming. We feel great joy that we are able to spend some time with them, that we're able to see how they're doing and see how things are going, and to be able to worship with them. And as Paul and Silas went through, they caused great joy unto all the brethren. And when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church. The church welcomed them there to come and be with them, and the apostles and elders, and they declared all things that God had done to them. That's the great joy that we have, to be able to declare the great things that God has done unto us. You know, he gave us his Spirit. He gave us his Spirit because it was his purpose and his will. of when he came to us. And he put his spirit into us. That point forward, we are now going to live forever. Our spirit will never ever die. This fleshly tabernacle that we have about us, that we walk around in, is going to die. Each and every one of us can see it now, because as we get older, it starts to be able to get old. Things don't work the way they used to. We're no longer young. We're able to realize that at one point in our lives that this body is not going to work anymore. Something about it's going to fail, and we're going to pass from this veil of temporal life. But at that moment that we pass, that spirit that is within us, that soul is going to go to heaven. For Paul tells us that, you know, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And what he's telling us is that at that moment of death, that we will be with him, that he will pick us up and he'll take us to be with him. We'll know him at that point. We will be able to see him. We will know him. Going back over to 1 John, I want to continue on with a little bit of thought that John had here. But as we walk in the light, now let me go up one more, just 6th verse of the 1st chapter. If we say that we have fellowship with him, or if we are telling one another that we have fellowship with God, or we're broadcasting that we have fellowship with God, but yet we walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. So if we are stating that we are having fellowship with God, but yet we walk in darkness. Now, what is darkness? Darkness is the opposite of light. In light, we can see what's happening. We know what's going on. But darkness is blank. There's nothing there. That is blank. It's darkness. It's evil. Because it's the opposite of light. Now, God is light. He made the light when he created this universe. I'm going to go over to the first chapter of the book of Genesis. And in the 3rd verse, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. Now, he put a river or a fence or a wall between the light and darkness. He did that before he made the sun or the moon. He was that light. God was that light. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. But there wasn't even a sun yet, or a moon. He created the light, or said, let there be light, on the first day. But over in the 14th verse, that's when God created the sun and the moon and the stars. And that was on the fourth day, I do believe. Let me see here. Yep, it was the fourth day. It starts at the 14th verse. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of heaven to divide the day from the night. Now, what's the difference between the two? There's a big difference between the two. God is that eternal light. His spirit is light. But the sun and the moon are a different light. His spirit goes into those that he chose are his people. That's the light. But the sun and the moon, they shine on everyone and everything. It doesn't make any difference between them. That's a natural thing. God is a spirit. That light from him is eternal. It will never, ever go away. We'll be here forever and ever. But God made the two lights and he set them in the firmament to rule over the day and over the night and to divide the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. That was in the fourth day. So think about those things. Think about that God created light on the first day, but it's not the light from the sun that he was talking about. It was a spiritual light. That light that each one of us have within us. You know, Paul tells us not to, or Jesus even told us, not to put a bushel over your light. That you don't put a bushel over a candle. Each one of us is a light. We have that light within us. And we're able to fellowship between it with each other. I'm going to go back to 1 John. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. Now, Jesus walks in that light. And John is telling us here, and if we walk in that light, now we have that light in us. Each one of his children has that light. But in order for us to walk in that light, then we have to do those things that he has asked us to do to be able to walk in that light. We don't want to be walking around in darkness and not knowing the things of God. Darkness is, like I told you, is blank. There's nothing there. So we want to walk in that light. You know, over in the, actually, let me go to Ephesians real quick. The third chapter. And it's talking about that light. And in the third chapter, in the eighth, let's go down to the ninth verse. And this is Paul talking. He's talking about himself being a minister. And he said, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery. That's that light that we have in us. That spirit that we have in us. That we might be able to fellowship and to understand the mysteries of God. Now he has revealed unto us some things here in his word. But there are some things that we don't know. Actually, there's probably a lot of things that we don't know. Because, you know, we sing that song that the half has never been told. And we see what we do see through a glass darkly. So it's almost like looking through these windows. You probably see probably a little bit more maybe than what appears. You can see the shadow through these windows, but you can't really see through them. Which from the beginning of the world has been hidden God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the things that we may know that God sent his ministers to be able to tell each other and to be able to not just the ministers, I'm talking about each other as brothers and sisters, to be able to tell each other, one another, those heavenly mysteries that were hid from the beginning. Now, God did give us inspiration of the book, the Bible. Those mysteries that we now know are the ones that are hid in this book. It takes God's Spirit to be in a person when they read the Bible to be able to understand what it means. If that wasn't the case, then everybody in the world would believe what we do. But they don't, because they're not understanding what they're reading. It takes God's hand in the matter to cause us to be able to understand those things. But he did these things to according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus. He purposed that the church would be able to know, make known those mysteries that the rest of the world doesn't have, that they don't understand. Those things about his love and his mercy and his grace, they can talk about those things and they know what the words mean, but they don't always put them in the right perspective when they're reading. Now, I'm not saying that we're always right 100% of the time, because I know we're not. There are a lot of scriptures where there's a lot of discussion and different ideas on what things mean, even among the old Baptists. But the basic things that we understand, we all agree on. But there are certain things that God reveals to each person as he sees fit, or to fulfill his purpose. John goes on. I'm going to read a little bit more to get to where I'm actually going. In the 8th verse of the 1st chapter of John, 1 John, if we say that we have no sin, we say, oh, well, we're not sinning. There's nothing what we're doing. Everything we're doing is right. Nothing is wrong. We deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. God tells us here by John's handwriting that if we lie about it and say that we're not sinning, then that means that we don't have the truth. Now, having the truth doesn't matter when it comes to your eternal home. There are many of God's children that do not have that truth. But there are a few that do have that truth, and that we know that we sin. Because we do, on a daily basis. If we confess our sins, which we do, God's Spirit is in us, it causes us to ask Him for forgiveness. And so we confess our sins, and He is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. His word here is a lowercase w. It's not the word Jesus Christ. It's His word, or His truth is not in us. Now, John goes on to talk a little bit about sinning. But he tells us a little bit. I'm going to skip a little bit. Follow me, go ahead and read it. You know, the first verse of the second chapter. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. Now, he's not telling us that we don't sin, but he's telling us to sin not. In other words, to remember Him, to remember His sinless life that he lived and to follow him. You know, Jesus tells us, I think it's over in Matthew. I'm going to go over there real quick. 16th verse. He tells us in the 16th verse, in the 24th, or 16th chapter, 24th verse, one of these days maybe I'll get my chapters and verses right. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Now, to be able to follow him, we got to do what he said. We have to deny ourselves. That we have to realize that we are nothing but sin in the flesh. That our sin comes from that flesh. And we have that spirit in us. But so we have to deny the flesh of its pleasures in order that we might follow him. It's very, very hard to do those things. And a lot of times, we're going to go ahead and sin. But because his spirit is in us, we do like John said. We confess our sins, and he is faithful to forgive us of what we've done. The man that is not regenerated, the man that lives outside of God, doesn't confess his sins. He doesn't think he's done anything wrong. But Jesus goes on to say in the 25th verse, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Now, I believe this is not talking about eternal life. This is talking about life in fellowship with him, or life in the church. Whosoever will save his life, or that life, that fleshly part of us, the part that wants to go out and do pleasurable things that oftentimes can be things that are against good, or not necessarily good, things that are sin. We're going to lose our spiritual blessings that we get while we're in this life. But if we will lose those things, lose that life, that's what it's talking about, lose that fleshly life, then we will gain a better spiritual life, a better spiritual understanding of him and of his kingdom. It takes work to do that. Jesus says to take his yoke upon us. And as the burden is light, guess what? Once you get there to doing those things, it's a little easier to continue to do those good things, to follow him. And you forget about the things of the flesh. But you have to work at it a little bit. It's not impossible for us to do. I want to go back over to 1 John. I'm going to restart the second chapter. He is the propitiation for our sins. Propitiation. I never say that right. He is the propitiation for our sins. That means that he has reconciled us, or he has atoned. We have been atoned, or paid, though our sin debt has been paid. So he has reconciled that with God because of his life and his death. For our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The world will read this, and they'll read this in the wrong context. John here has been talking to the children of God. That's who he's writing to. And the world that he's talking about here, that whole world, is that whole world of the children of God. It's not including those that are dead in sin, the unregenerate man. And hereby, we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. If we don't do those things that he asks, if we live a life of sin and frivolousness and gaiety, then we're in jeopardy of losing that spiritual life here, timely life, that we have here in this life. But whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby we know that we are in him. God is love. He is a perfect love. He has given us, or has given us, that ability to be able to love one another and to love him because of that love that he gave us. We love him because he first loved us. He loved us from the very beginning. He loved us when yet there were none of us. He loved us. And he has shed abroad that love in our hearts, that we may be able to love one another. And that is how we know that we are in him, because we're able to love the brethren. That's how we know it. He that saith he abideth in him ought also to walk even as he walked. Referring back over to Matthew 16, where Jesus said that we need to follow him, that we need to give up our life, that we may follow him. But if we hold on to that fleshly, sinful life, then we're going to lose that spiritual life that we have. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning. You know, John talks about that beginning. He talks about that living word, Jesus Christ, in the first chapter of the Gospel of John. Again, a new commandment I write unto you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is past. Jesus Christ has come. He has preached his gospel unto men, and men have taken that gospel and have spread it around the whole world. You know, Paul wrote that it was already done, that he had preached over the whole world. Well, he had preached over around that area, around Europe, Southern Europe, and Eastern Asia, in Northern Africa, and in the Middle East. And at that time, they thought that was the whole world. And that's what Paul means. But today, that word or that gospel found itself here on this continent by those that were being persecuted from Europe and Africa. They brought with them that word. Some of them brought the pure word, the real truth. They were old Baptists, if you will. And when they came here, their name was Baptist. And so now that gospel has gone over the entire globe. There's probably not one single country in this world in which that gospel has not gone unto you, gone unto. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. For us that are in that light, that are able to love our brother and to do unto him the things that we would have done unto us, those abilities are given to us by God, and it's because of that light that we walk in. That if we walk in that light, then we're not going to stumble. We're not going to fall. And in that darkness, if we retreat back and let the flesh come take over, we're going to fall back in that darkness. We're going to stumble and we're going to fall while we're in this life. And we're going to treat each other badly if we do those things. This nation has come to a point where there are a lot of people that are stumbling in that darkness. They are not treating one another as a brother. They are not doing those things that God tells us to do. And the more they do of those things, the farther away they get from Him, even though they may be His children. And it's happening today in this world, in this nation. And it's getting worse. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness, and walketh in darkness, and knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness hath blinded his eyes. From the very beginning, God has told us to love our brother or each other. Let me go over to Leviticus in the 19th chapter of Leviticus, starting in the 17th verse. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thine heart. That's a commandment from God, that we shall not hate thy brother in thine heart. It takes a heart from God, a fleshly heart, to be able to love thy brother as God has commanded unto us. But I believe that there is a propensity of that human, natural man's behavior that can come upon us and cause us to hate one another. While at the same time, His Spirit is in us. Sometimes that flesh can cause us to do things that we should not do. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thine heart. Thou shalt in any wise rebuke thy neighbor and not suffer sin upon him. We need to treat one another as God tells us here, as we would have been treated. We should not ever do each other wrong. Thou shalt not avenge, nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people. He's telling us that even though we may do bad things one to another, that we should not avenge or have any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am Lord, the Lord. We seem to have forgotten this. A lot of people in this life or in this country have forgotten this. And even though that God has put it in His book, and we read it, and most men nowadays in this country know that that's what it says. If they have ever professed themselves to be a Christian, knows that God wants us to love one another, knows that God wants us to treat each other right, knows that He wants us to be good one unto another and to love each other. And John goes on. He says, I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for His name's sake. He forgave our sins because He died on the cross in our stead. I write unto you, fathers, because ye have known Him that is from the beginning, that is from the first that Jesus came upon this earth and walked as a man, that these fathers or the older people that were on the earth at that time knew Him from the beginning of His ministry. I write unto you, young men, because ye have overcome the wicked one. They have overcome that devil. They have overcome the things that the devil comes to us and tries to draw us away from God. He comes to that flesh and he plays on that flesh and tries to draw us away from that good things that he wants us to do. I write unto you, young men, because ye have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because ye have known the Father. Those children that he's talking about are the children of God, that when he imparts his Spirit in us, he gives us knowledge in that. We know him, and we're able then to understand his ways. We're able then to know things about him without man telling us, without us learning it from somewhere else. Paul tells us that when he started his ministry, that he got that from God. That he didn't get it from men. He didn't learn it of men. He didn't learn it anywhere else, but from God. And God does the same thing with each of us. And depending upon what we do, the if ye will, if we will do those things that Christ tells us, he will give us more and a little bit more. Here a little and there a little. He is not going to just pile it on us all at once. But if we continue to do those things, he will give us more and more. I have written unto you, fathers, because ye have known him, that is from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because ye are strong, and the word of God abideth in you. Because God has imparted unto us knowledge that now lives in us. It abides in us, and we're able to know that word. And ye have overcome that wicked one. It gives us the ability to be able to say, get behind me, Satan. I don't want anything to do with you. It gives us the ability to then come to God and ask him for his mercy and his grace and to be like unto Jesus, and that we look unto him for everything. Jesus came and he said, it's not his will, but it's God's will that he wanted to be done. And we need to be the same way. It's not our will, but it's God's will that we should be the same way. We need to be a little closer to him, and we have to be able to grow closer a little bit at a time. Okay? Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. The world that he's talking about here is the world that is in darkness. The world that doesn't know him. The world that does things that are against him, that are an abomination unto him. If any man love the world, those bad things, the love of the Father is not in him. Our spirit loves God. Our spirit that's in us, that came from God, is what causes us to love him. We do not love the darkness. We're the opposite of darkness. We have that light. We have that light in us that we're able to love him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. Those things that cause us to be at error with one another, are these things. It's the lust of the flesh. Those things that we want. Those things that the flesh desires. Those things that Satan draws us away into, those lustly things of the flesh. And the pride of life. You know, people nowadays sort of teach their young as they're growing up that they need to be proud and have that pride built up in them. It's not like it used to be. When I grew up, it wasn't really that way. There was more humility than there is now. Men today are not humble. It's hard to find somebody that's humble. But those that are prideful are everywhere. They're all about my work. They all are just so proud of the things that they've done. They're so proud of how much money they made. Those things are of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Those that God has given his life unto, those that have his spirit in him, will abide forever. That means we will always live with him in glory. That when this life is over, we'll be with him. But in this life, we have the ability to live a good life and to do those things that are right. And that is what we're deeply lacking in this country right now. We're deeply lacking those things. We're seeing that the lust of the flesh and the pride of life has taken over many, many, many more people than what are his people, than the ones that actually love him. They've taken it over. And I do believe that we're headed down a bad road. Throughout history, since the time of Christ, the church has moved from place to place. And I'm deeply afraid that one day we're going to be in danger here, that we're going to be unable to come and worship the way we are, that we're going to feel persecution the way that they felt in the past. But right now, it's not that way. You know, over in 2 Chronicles, Samuel wrote to us, let me go there. I'll never be able to say it right, if I can even find it. I think it's the 16th chapter. Oh. It's a 6. Seems like it's got a 6 in it somewhere. I think y'all know where I'm headed. In the 6th chapter of 2 Chronicles, in the 26th verse. When the heaven is shut up, and there is no rain, because they have sinned against thee, yet if they pray toward this place, and confess thy name, and turn from their sin, when thou dost afflict them, then hear thou from heaven, and forgive the sin of thy servants and of thy people Israel, when thou hast taught them the good way wherein they should walk, and send rain upon the land which thou hast given unto thy people for an inheritance. You know, God has told us that if we will humble ourselves, if his people will humble themselves and pray, and turn from our wicked ways, then he will heal our land. And I ask that y'all think about those things. That y'all think about what's going on in the world. I know we shouldn't think about it too much, because he is always going to be here to protect us and to help us. But pray that he will forgive us, that he will give us more mercy, that he will give us his grace. We know that he loves us. And we know that he will continue to love us all down through time, until we are finally with him one day. I thank y'all very much.